IVM.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to All Things Policy. Today, Pranav and I have with us Vipin Narang. He's Associate Professor of Political Science at MIT. He's one of the leading thinkers in nuclear strategy in the world today. His book, Nuclear Strategy in the Modern Era, is a landmark work. And earlier this year, he, along with Christopher Clary, had written a paper titled India's Counterforce Temptations, which I think was basically read by everyone in India. All right. So welcome to the podcast, Vipin.
Thank you, Aditya. Thank you, Pranav. It's a pleasure to be here.
All right.
That was a good intro.
Actually, why don't we just get started on
sure.
that? Basically, why did you write that paper?
Well, okay. So let's take it back basically 2 years earlier in 2017. I had been asked to speak on this panel at the Carnegie Nuclear Policy Conference in March of that year. And it was a panel on no first use. I said, okay, where is South Asia on no first use? We know where India is on the doctrine. It has this qualified no first use in the 2003 official doctrine. And Shivshankar Menon had been at MIT the previous semester with us. We had chatted about nuclear policy. But he had written this book, Choices, which had come out. And I hadn't yet read his chapter on no first use, which is titled Why India Has No First Use. Note, it does not say India should have no first use. The title is Why India Has No First Use. And it's a very interesting chapter, which, you know, one should read very carefully several times. And I said, okay, let's see what former National Security Advisor Rice's chapter on nuclear no first use. I'm supposed to be on this panel on no first use. Let me at least update my knowledge of India's no first use. I start reading the chapter and I just happened to open up to the page. I mean, this is how academia works sometimes. Like I had flipped open the book and opened up to the page where he has this paragraph talking about, you know, if Pakistan used tactical nuclear weapons, it would free India for a comprehensive first strike against Pakistan. And I said, wait. This is a chapter on no first use. What the hell is he talking about? And it was interesting that I opened up to that page in isolation, because if you read, it's easy to miss that paragraph in the flow of the chapter because he goes, you know, through the history of India's no first use policy, talks about the gray area, and then he talks about, you know, well, what happens if Pakistan uses tactical nuclear weapons? And it wasn't that India would retaliate. The phrase he used, which caught my eye, was comprehensive first strike. And for somebody steeped in nuclear jargon, that is a red flag for Counterforce. And it just, the light bulbs went off. And so I made what is now, I think, considered to be a controversial presentation at the Carnegie Nuclear Policy Conference on, well, maybe, you know, if India is interested in thinking about counterforce, it would explain this discomfort that India has persistently had with an absolute no first use policy, particularly for this issue of preemption. Why? Everyone got hung up on no first use, and I guess it was a no first use panel. But the issue with counterforce is that you can't afford to go second, because you have to be able to use all your weapons to destroy your adversary's capabilities, and you can't risk attrition of your forces. And so baked into counterforce is this idea of preemption. And if you qualify no first use for preemption, you can make counterforce work, or you have to have a policy of essentially first use. So this is why I found that chapter really interesting. He talks about this exception potentially for preemption in context of counterforce. And that's where marrying the two made a lot of sense finally, which was, you know, maybe India's discomfort with an absolute no first use, particularly for preemption, was because there might be this interest somewhere deep down in counterforce. And then after that, after I got attacked viciously everywhere, and I don't think I was wrong about the no first use policy. I think Rajnath Singh's statement this year vindicated a lot of the arguments there. But the reality is India's never been comfortable, I think, with an absolute no first use policy, despite what, you know, I think many in Delhi at the time screamed from the top of their lungs, oh, there's no evidence of change. No one ever said you're going to change a doctrine. But there's always been the discomfort. First of all, the doctrine itself is qualified for chem-bio use. But the draft nuclear doctrine itself was not an absolute no-for-use policy. It was about initiating a strike, you know, and India wouldn't be the first to initiate a strike, which meant if it had detected that Pakistan was initiating, it would free India of the strictures of no-for-use. And then you had Parikar, and then you had Menon, and then you had Nagel, and then you had finally Rajnath Singh. So I think it's very difficult. If that isn't, if Rajnath Singh's official crafted formulation at Pokhran was not enough to convince people that India at least is at the highest level uncomfortable with absolute no first use policy, I question what evidence people would need to suggest that India is, you know, might be thinking about qualifications to its no first use policy, especially for preemption. But then Chris and I spent the next 2 years thinking about, well, so if India has this interest, can it do it? And there, I think we landed an area which probably is also controversial, is that if you are interested in it, India is really not in a good position to do this because Pakistan's responses make India's any counterforce temptation very difficult to implement. Pakistan can build up, it can build out, it can disperse, it can deploy and move systems around. And you'd really have to catch Pakistan napping. And that's unlikely in this particular case. But that doesn't mean that the interest doesn't persist. A lot of the technologies we see being pursued seem to suggest that, you know, this interest might still be supported, but we argue it may be destabilizing in peacetime because Pakistan will continue to expand its capabilities in numbers and quality, which would force India to do so to keep up. But in a crisis especially, if Pakistan is afraid that India is going to go first, then that creates incentives for Pakistan to go first also, right? So it doesn't have this use them or lose them temptation. And so it creates real crisis instabilities. And so we argue, you know, India may have this temptation for really strong, rational reasons. You know, how long can you sit back and take terrorism from a state that uses nuclear weapons as a shield? But it does create real risk. So there needs to be this debate. The reason to write the article is, you know, if you're interested in this, then think about the consequences. Can you really keep up? At this point, I'm not sure the cat can be put in the bag. But, you know, the idea is to surface the debate, to have people like you guys debate, you know, how good an idea it is.
Vipin, you do sometimes bring up this, like General Nagel does, this problem, you know, this moral dilemma that an Indian decision maker might have, where, you know, there seems to be an imminent strike from Pakistan, and what does India do?
Right.
But to my mind, the first question that comes is, how do I know they really mean it? How do I know that's not just coercive diplomacy?
Right. Well, and this is where misperception and crises, you know, you see Pakistan moving a Nasser system. They may be signaling, okay, the end is coming, you know, but we don't intend to use it. We just want you to know. Versus they really believe the end is coming and they're preparing the Nasser for use. That's very difficult, I think, to assess with any confidence. It's interesting that I think at some point, I'm not sure Menon said this, but I think there was always this percolating rumor within the military, so maybe it was Nagel or others in discussion, where movement of Nasser's would be the signal of potential imminent use. And if they detected movement of Nasser's, because the idea is that Nasser's are centrally controlled, and once they're dispersed out, they lose negative control. And so there would be few physical impediments on whoever possessed the Nasser battery to use them. And that would free the IAF or whoever to go Nasser hunting. And also potentially then India to go after the strategic, the long-range systems also. I mean, you raise a really good question. Like, what is the standard of evidence you need for imminence? That's a very difficult question. I think that bedevils every country, nuclear country, non-nuclear country. Then the question is, but even if you hit that standard, would you then relieve the strictures of no first use so that you wouldn't expose your citizens or armed forces to a first use? And that's the moral dilemma. I think that's what Nagel is talking about. And I think, you know, that's a real question about, you know, democracy. Like, if a democratically elected leader is saying, I will accept a nuclear hit on my citizens or my armed forces before I respond, is that moral? I don't know. I mean, I think that's the question he raises.
Okay, there's just one last question I want to ask you about India's NFU, which is, you know, you make the argument that it's really eroded in substance, right? Mm-hmm. Now, what if India were to come up with a new nuclear doctrine, which reaffirms this commitment to NFU, that uses very clear language about what it's going to do, addresses things like nuclear terrorism. Do you think that would repair some of the damage?
It might. I mean, I think once doubts about no first use creep in, they're very hard to put back in. And I think over the past 20 years, India's wanted to have its cake and eat its too. It declares no first use, so it gets the benefits of being viewed and seen as a responsible nuclear power, but injects ambiguity about no first use to get the deterrent benefits of having ambiguous intentions about no first use. And I think the argument could be made at this point, because that doctrine would not be released in isolation. In context, it could still be viewed as, you know, left hand, right hand, you know, trying to have your cake and eat it also. But it depends on the language, and it depends, I think, more actually on the stewardship of the forces and the disposition. You know, if you demate your systems and walk back from canisterized systems and SLBMs, which I don't think is going to happen, then maybe it can be made more credible. But I think at this point, Pakistan has never believed India's no first use policy. At this point, I don't think India believes its own no first use policy.
Okay, we've spoken about all of this, but let's take a step back, because you in your earlier works have argued that the India-Pakistan dyad is stable, and this stability is primarily created also because of India's no first use. And you've conducted some empirical tests, but can you explain why it's essentially very stable?
Well, I call it an ugly stability. I mean, it's stable in the sense that so long as, you know, there were two reasons why it was stable. One was an unsustainable reason, which is Indian restraint, right? So India suffered attacks and invade, like Kargil, parliament attack, Mumbai, and restraint is perhaps in India's long-term strategic interest, but it is difficult to sell domestically. But if India is committed to restraint, then there was stability. It was an ugly stability, but it was stable. The other reason it was stable with a no first use policy that was at least generally believed to be adhered to and credible is that even if India retaliated with conventional forces and tripped Pakistan's nuclear red line at the battlefield level, you still wouldn't have nuclear escalation, because it is unlikely that India would have responded to battlefield use with a massive counter-value retaliation against Pakistan. I think the second that Pakistan used a tactical, or I don't like tactical, battlefield nuclear weapon on its own soil, the world comes to a screeching halt, and I don't think any Indian prime minister, any leader, would kill millions of Pakistanis in retaliation for that. And so it was an ugly stability because it forced India to basically suffer the harms. But now we're getting to a point where even talk of Indian counterforce by Nagal and Shivshankar Menon creates, on the one hand, I think the aim is to create doubt in Pakistan's mind that it can get away with a tactical nuclear weapon, battlefield nuclear weapon use, and get in, and that trickles all the way down. It has to create doubts about whether Pakistan can sponsor terrorism on the Indian homeland, because it does so behind the ultimate shield is the strategic nuclear weapon systems, all of the forces that it retains for the second strike. So if you can threaten the survivability of its forces, those long-range forces, then you may be able to deter even subconventional attacks then, right? Because the only way Pakistan's strategy works is if it can retain these long-range forces to deter Indian massive retaliation. So if you threaten their long-range forces, then you may be able to reestablish deterrence. But that does create these instabilities then. Pakistan keeps building up, moving out, and first use and first strike incentives in a crisis. So what we're seeing in South Asia is the evolution of this ugly stability. I think it's still stable at some level, but it's a very ugly stability. And anytime you start getting one nuclear power, you know, provoking another one with terrorism, and then, you know, at some point the cumulative effect of frustration on the Indian side leads to, you know, reactions like Balakot, where you have for the first time in history a nuclear power using kinetic power on the sovereign territory of another nuclear power. And at some point, you know, that ugly stability will get really ugly, and it's a very tenuous stability in that regard.
One of the other dyads that's not really spoken about and that's not really caught attention is the India-China dyad. China has a no first use on which it does not place any conditions. So how have you viewed this India-China dyad?
Yeah, so I mean, there are doubts in the U.S. about the validity of China's no first use policy, especially in a crisis or conflict, but it certainly has taken steps to make it more credible during peacetime than any other state with very recessed, demated forces. In the India-China dyad, this is the question I ask. Would there ever be a conceivable scenario where India's conventional forces were getting beat so badly that they, you would think that it would they would need to offset those losses with nuclear first use against Chinese conventional forces. And I don't see any scenario, given the force balance, given the stakes, given the advantages that India has, you know, in the localized terrain areas, where that would be plausible. And one concern with Rajnath Singh's statement was, well, what if the statement about the future circumstances wasn't about Pakistan, but about China? And that there might be circumstances where it's conceivable that India might find it useful to use nuclear weapons first against Chinese forces. And I ran through these scenarios, and I just can't think of any plausible ones. And so for me, you know, I think that dyad is quite stable. And, you know, local skirmishes don't really have the potential to escalate into a strategic conflict or, you know, anything further than that. So the more probable dyad of risk is India-Pakistan.
Well, finally, I would like to get to something that's extremely timely. That's North Korea, and you've worked a lot on that. We've seen the summit that happened on June 12th, followed by the Hanoi summit, and followed by a few exchanges of love letters and, and a meeting in the DMZ. How do you see this going? Where is this leading to? Was Hanoi a missed opportunity? And where is this all leading to in the end?
Yeah, I do think Hanoi was a missed opportunity. I think the goal in Singapore for the U.S., North Korea and Kim Jong-un are not giving up their nuclear weapons, right? The best we can hope for is essentially arms control, slowing down the growth of the program, capping fissile material production and capability production. At Hanoi, it is believed to have been the case that Kim Jong-un put all of the Yongbyon facility, including its 5-megawatt reactor, it's the experimental IRT reactor, plus some subset of the uranium enrichment capability that North Korea has. Not the uranium enrichment outside of Yongbyon, but that inside. And he wanted sanctions relief. In terms of scope, that's not a bad deal, right? There would have been questions about sequencing, but that was a chance to really slow down the growth of North Korea's program. And starving the program of plutonium and tritium has real effects on the composition of its future force. And it would have built trust, you know, for you know, further arms control talks. When Hanoi failed, I think Kim Jong-un was really surprised. And it's led to this year where there was a period of quiet where I think either Kim Jong-un had to face hardliners at home or they're trying to calculate how to deal with the U.S. after the failure at Hanoi. And they've set this end-of-year deadline. And in our experience as analysts, it's usually good to take Kim Jong-un at his word. He doesn't usually bluff. And they say, you know, they've said if the U.S. doesn't show a new calculation, and so far there hasn't been any evidence of that on the U.S. side, especially on sanctions relief, then North Korea will have to find a new way. And for me, the new way is just the old way with longer range missiles. And so the concern in the new year is, you know, maybe Kim Jong-un is bluffing. I do think his best bet is Donald Trump as president for what he wants, which is breaking the alliance with South Korea, getting the U.S. to withdraw from there. But it's plausible that the hardliners have at home, you know, and we don't know a lot about North Korean domestic politics, but it's plausible or possible that they've given Kim Jong-un until the end of the year. And if not, then he's got to show, you know, restart maybe longer-range missile tests, MRBMs, another SLBM, satellite launch, maybe an ICBM test. I don't think we're in the vicinity of nuclear tests yet. But I think we could get back to the temperature of 2017 very quickly. And the clock is ticking, right? We have a month left from today, essentially, for the U.S. to convince North Korea that it has that it's interested in negotiating and maybe Yongbyon again for sanctions relief. You know, if that deal is still on the table, maybe it's worth exploring it. But right now, I don't think the contact is significant enough to explore that deal in detail. So let's see what happens. But I'm not optimistic that 2019 will be as smooth as 2018. And for the record, North Korea has tested more missiles in 2019 than any other year in its history. So this wasn't a quiet year. It was just short-range tests. But we shouldn't be comforted by the short-range tests, which were solid fuel, mobile, and they provide a lot of advantages to the North Korean program, which may show up in their long-range systems also.
And how does China view these negotiations between the U.S. and North Korea?
I think, you know, China is kind of sitting pretty, right? Because ultimately, China fears a collapsed and weak North Korea more than it fears a nuclear North Korea. And in a lot of ways, North Korea is a distraction for the U.S., less bandwidth for the U.S. to deal with China and the trade war and, you know, criticize China for all the things it's doing. And I don't think China likes to see North Korean nuclear tests or ICBMs, but it's also been responsible for taking all of the air out of the maximum pressure campaign. China and Russia have basically undermined sanctions, the sanctions campaign. And so China's sitting pretty, I think. It's a buffer between South Korea and the U.S. Western forces and China. And so this kind of works for China because it's a distraction for the U.S. And that just benefits China in its long-term, long-term strategy with the U.S.
Okay. Finally, we are seeing arms control under great pressure or basically collapsing, right? The INF Treaty expired this year and New START seems to be under threat. So what does that mean? So what would that mean for the U.S.-Russia dyad and how would China react to it?
Yeah, I mean, asking China to join a multilateral New START equivalent is kind of a non-starter because it just doesn't have very many deployed forces. And that's an invitation for them to sprint up to parity. And so I'm not sure what the rationale is for – eventually you may want to get China into an arms control arrangement, but I think now is probably not the time and China is not interested. They've made it very clear they're not interested. With Russia, you know, the U.S. has long been concerned that forces that are not covered by New START are expanding at a rapid pace in Russia. But Russia has no interest in getting those covered under New START. So I think if New START lapses, if President Trump is reelected and chooses not to extend New START, it's plausible that the U.S., you know, increases the number of deployed systems it has by remerving ICBMs, its SLBMs, and puts pressure on Russia in an arms race on the theory that it can beat Russia in an arms race in a strategic arms competition. But that's a very risky game. I mean, these are kind of the worst habits of the Cold War that are being relived, right? So everything that's old is new again. For my money, not extending New START would be a big mistake for the U.S. and Russia, though, because it's one of the few treaties that has bipartisan support. If you're a counterforcer, you like it because you can, you know exactly how many weapons you have to hit, how many systems you have to hit, where they are, they're verified. And if you're an arms controller, you like New START. So unless you like an arms race, New START should be extended.
Okay. Thanks, Vipin. That's been an awesome conversation. And thank you all for joining us on All Things Policy.
Thank you, guys. That was a lot of fun.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVMPodcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle, @TakshashilaInst, or our website, takshashila.org.in.
Hi, I'm Sariu Natarajan.
And I'm Alok Prasanna Kumar.
And we are the hosts of the Ganatantra podcast.
On this podcast, we speak to academics, social scientists, journalists, and activists to find out what's actually going on in Indian politics.
On this podcast, we stay away from personality politics, intrigue, and gossip, and instead focus on the data, research, and analysis that drives all this.
So tune in to the Ganatantra podcast, where new episodes are out every Wednesday on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you listen to your podcasts.
Look, up in the internet. It's a meme. No, it's a cat video. No, it's the Geek Fruit Podcast.
That's right. We interrupt this riveting broadcast to tell you about our show, The Geek Fruit Podcast, where Tejas, Dinkar, and I, Jishnu, talk about everything in pop culture, including DC, Marvel, Star Wars, Netflix, and everything in between.
You know how your friends hate it when you ramble about some nerdy crap and you just want somebody to listen to you? Well, sorry, there's nothing we can do about that, but come listen to us ramble and it'll almost be like the real thing. Kind of.
Listen to new episodes of the Geek Fruit Podcast every Monday and the Geek Fruit Bulletin every Thursday on iTunes, Google Podcasts, the IVM app, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Happy listening, you nerds.